planets. These interactive webinars are free and open to the public, and recordings of each will be posted soon after the end of each lecture.
The Bisan Center for Research and Development is a non-partisan civil society organization that was founded back in 1989. We work on connecting young scholars with the global community of research to contribute to the creation and establishment of these connections and this community of learning, where sciences of all forms can be used and utilized for the benefit of man.
The Bisan Lecture Series is the response of the international academic community to the Israeli attacks against the inalienable right of the Palestinian people to education and academic freedom. We stand in solidarity with the six Palestinian NGOs targeted by the Israeli government, and through them, with the entirety of Palestinian civil society.
Welcome, everyone, to this inaugural session of the Bisan Lecture Series. I'm Haynes Miller. I'm a member of the Bisan Lecture Series Steering Committee, and I'm pleased to moderate this first lecture. These monthly webinars are designed to span a wide range of subjects of cultural, scientific, and societal importance, with the general objective of contributing to the further integration of Palestine into the global community of learning. In an effort to maximize the reach of these seminars, the Bisan Center has arranged for simultaneous translation between English and Arabic in the Zoom presentation of the lecture. To avail yourself of this option, look at the bottom of your Zoom screen. You should see a globe icon. If you select it, you'll be given a choice of language. This lecture series is jointly sponsored by Scientists for Palestine, the Bisan Center for Research and Development, and the Columbia University Center for Palestinian Studies. We're extremely grateful to Scientists for Palestine for its leadership, its very professional social media outreach, and for providing the technical infrastructure for today's webinar. The Bisan Center has collaborated with S4P for many years. For example, it provided invaluable venue in Ramallah for the organization and broadcast of the Science for Palestine conference at MIT in January 2020. At the time of the conference, the executive director of the Bisan Center was in fact in Israeli administrative detention. But not today. We're lucky to have Obai Aboudi with us today, and he'll talk a little more about the mission of the Bisan Center. Obai.
Thank you, Haynes. Thanks for the Bisan Lecture Series Steering Committee and for Scientists for Palestine for organizing this solidarity action. As is well known, solidarity is a verb, and among academia, there's no stronger words than doing scientific connections, academic activities together as an act of solidarity in the face of insurmountable oppression and unjustifiable repression against the Palestinian civil society in general and Palestinian community especially, and especially against the six organizations that have been wrongfully designated as terrorist organizations. We at the Bisan Center have been active for the past 33 years in spreading critical analytical research on asymmetrical power relations that are affecting the Palestinian community and especially those that are less fortunate and most marginalized in this. I am pleased also to announce that We have just published our latest study, Shrinking Space for Women Activists, which should be available from tomorrow on our website for people to look at and see. And this comes also at a critical moment when the Israeli occupation has just published an order that is limiting international academics' entry into the Palestinian community. For Palestinian community, the military commander of the West Bank has just issued an order saying that they have to pre-approve every professor that wants to come and lecture at Palestinian universities in the West Bank, and limited the number of international students at Palestinian universities to 150 students annually. So thank you for the act of solidarity, and together we will prevail on this act of injustice.
Thank you, Abai, and for this and for your great courage and leadership. Before I introduce today's speaker, a word about the structure of this webinar. While the lecture is going on, please contribute questions and topics for further discussion in the chat, either on Zoom or on Facebook Live. We'll collect these comments and bring them up at the end of the talk for discussion. There will be plenty of time for discussion at the end. As you can see, the webinar is being recorded. The video will be posted on S4P website and on YouTube. Now down to business. We're extremely fortunate to have, as the inaugural speaker in the Bisan Lecture Series, George Smith, Curator's Distinguished Professor Emeritus of Biological Sciences at the University of Missouri. In 2018, the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded to George, along with Greg Winter of the Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, England, and Francis Arnold of Caltech. The prize recognized their work in employing the biological process of natural selection to pick out proteins with specific bioactive properties. We'll see in George's talk today that he sees the metaphor of biological processes as applicable in intellectual and social history, as well as in his laboratory. I'm also happy to report that George shares my interest in mathematics education and was for years a participant in a cross-departmental project to merge mathematics and biology in an educational program at Mizzou. George has a long history of political activism, beginning with the American War in Southeast Asia, and is a lead organizer of the Mid-Missourians for Justice in Palestine. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome George Smith. His title is The Virology of Ideas, a Necessary Pandemic. George, you're muted.
Thank you. Shukran, Ubay, and Haynes. greetings, salam, shalom to everyone. It's a privilege to give the inaugural Bisan lecture. Before I start, though, a word about SARS-CoV-2, the virus that's responsible for the pandemic. The red things sticking out from the surface in this image represent the virus's spike protein, the protein that orchestrates the infection process. It's not actually red. Spike is the target of nearly all COVID-19 vaccine initiatives, including the remarkable project that Dr. Gertrudis Rojas, director of the Center of Molecular Immunology in Havana, will describe in the third Bisan lecture. Here, though, the virus serves as a metaphor for an idea my vaguely defined term for an element of culture. It's culture, as you've heard, along with community, that are at the heart of the Bisan Lecture Series declared declaration, aspiration to help integrate Palestine more fully into the global cultural community. My cultural analogy is totally unoriginal. Cultural evolution has long been likened to evolution in the natural world. Equating ideas to genes is a particularly common conceit because of genes' ability to replicate and mutate. But today, the closely related image of a virus seems even more compelling, not only because of this accursed pandemic, but also because in 2018, Greg Winter and I shared half of the Nobel Chemistry Prize for our role in developing a technology called phage display. Phages are viruses that infect bacteria. My personal experience of culture has been mostly scientific, of course, and scientific communities are what I'll concentrate on. But unlike some writers, most notably Karl Popper, I don't think there's a defensible demarcation between what's science and what's non-science. What I have to say today about science and technology, I believe applies to the broad cultural enterprise. Our brains teem with bright ideas, more haphazardly organized, I'm sure, than implied in this cartoon. They're constantly proliferating. And as they proliferate, they undergo tiny changes, sort of intellectual mutations. And as they proliferate and mutate, they interact with one another on a massive scale, producing a great profusion of mongrel ideas of mixed parentage. When we speak, when we write, when we make things other people can use, or take other public actions, we are in effect releasing our ideas into the environment in infectious form. Our brains create an environment that's densely populated with infectious ideas. An ideosphere, as I'll call it, by analogy with a biosphere in the natural world. Other brains' ideas infect our own brains, adding to the teeming multitudes that are already there. All this proliferation must be balanced by ruthless culling by cultural selection. Most ideas meet obscure deaths of neglect in the struggle for existence. Their space being taken up by other, fitter ideas. Very rarely, there arise superstar ideas, conspicuous cultural achievements. that proliferate through the ideosphere at exceptional rates. Think of them as the intellectual analogs of the SARS-CoV-2 Omicron variant that has swept over the globe. Let me pose an epidemiological question. Is the person, possibly somewhere in southern Africa, who breathed out the first Omicron variant virus, personally responsible for that variant? No biologist would answer yes to such a question. Let's look at the last 20 months of the phylogeny, the family tree, of a small sampling of the millions of SARS-CoV-2 viruses whose chromosomes have been analyzed. The bundle of branches in the upper part of the figure constitute the Omicron variant lineage. Each of the orange and red dots on those branches plots the position of a particular Omicron variant virus sampled on a particular date from a particular person. Other colored dots plot viruses in the Delta, Eta, Kappa, Beta, Epsilon, Iota, Lambda, Mu, and Alpha lineages. Could any particular person represented in the Omicron lineage be said to be the origin of Omicron? And what about the hundreds of millions of people who are not represented by colored dots on the Omicron lineage? In fact, before early September last year, Omicrons were so rare, they weren't detected at all. Yet, the random mutations that ultimately gave Omicron its superior infectiousness were steadily accumulating in those anonymous people, wherever they lived. Manifestly, no single person, whether or not represented by a dot, is the origin of the Omicron variant. It emerged from random mutation plus natural selection in a gigantic global community of infected people. And the analogous cultural question, is a superstar idea the personal intellectual property of the individual who first released it into the ideosphere? Surely this too is nonsense. I should know. I'm one of the supposed scientific innovators. In 2018, in preparation for my Nobel lecture, I started to catalog the major contributions of members of my scientific community to phage display, the technology for which the prize was being awarded. I soon gave up. The list was going to be way too long to include. Indeed, I'm hard-pressed to identify any contributions that remain truly my own. In particular, almost all the ramifications that have made phage display prominent enough to be recognized by a Nobel Prize are contributions of my fellow scientists, including my co-laureate, Greg Winter. I think all scientific discoveries and technological innovations are like this. They emerge from great overlapping communities of workers, sharing their infectious ideas and material resources over time and space. No individual is the creator. All community members are temporary hosts for a community-acquired intellectual infections. Treating a conspicuous scientific discovery or technological innovation as if it were the personal intellectual property of a single person or group is patently unjust. More important, though, is that it damages creativity by impeding the free sharing of ideas. The injustice and the damage are particularly severe when intellectual property rights take the form of government-enforced patent monopolies. Consider, as an example, the patent monopolies that are being enforced for the spectacularly successful messenger RNA vaccines against SARS-CoV-2. This technology is the fruit of a focused initiative that has been ongoing now for almost 30 years in many laboratories across the globe, almost all of them publicly funded. And that 30-year initiative has relied in turn on critical discoveries and advances by thousands of publicly funded research groups in immunology, molecular biology, chemistry, physics, and other disciplines over a span of at least a century. By right, these vaccines belong to the people of the world at large, the people who have sustained the science over all those decades. Yet, a handful of corporations responsible for minute contributions to the technology are permitted to manufacture and sell these vaccines at monopoly prices without fear of competition. And they're allowed to withhold crucial manufacturing know-how from enterprises all over the world who together might produce enough vaccine to vaccinate every person on the globe. Let us not demean the corporation's contributions, though. They were indeed remarkable achievements. It's only in comparison to the century of publicly funded scientific discoveries and technological advances on which they critically relied, many of which were themselves remarkable achievements, that the corporation's contributions can be called minute. Was the promise of enormous fiscal rewards in the form of patent monopolies necessary to motivate the corporation's achievements? I don't think so. A number of economists argue that pharmaceuticals, including vaccines, could be developed more effectively and far more cheaply with direct public funding than with the promise of patent monopolies. We should keep in mind that it has been the scientists and engineers at the corporations, not the investors, not the financial officers, not the lobbyists, not the patent lawyers, who are actually responsible for the vaccine's development. Those scientists and engineers' brains are at a disadvantage. They have to work in a constricted ideosphere. They can't make use of information that might compromise intellectual property rights. And of course, they can't release their own ideas freely into the global ideosphere either. Again, lest intellectual property rights might be compromised. What if they'd been free to share their ideas and resources? Might not their achievements have been even more spectacular? The need to protect intellectual property rights imposes another important constraint on these talented scientists and engineers' work. Free dissemination of scientific ideas and resources, as I'm doing now at this very minute, mediates science's primary reward system, acquiring the esteem and respect of our scientific peers. Of course, scientists and engineers demand the wherewithal to live comfortably as compensation for their labor. But here, I'm talking about another type of reward, a cultural reward. We scientists are an ambitious lot. We crave recognition for our work. We strive to earn recognition by explaining our ideas clearly to our students and colleagues in written and spoken word, by supporting our ideas with well-planned, workmanlike experiments, by distributing the resulting material resources freely among our fellow scientists. This, I think, far more than material compensation, is what drives our ambition. And is this not an estimable ambition, and one that depends on our diligence rather than incredible good luck? But who's to know of our diligence if we don't make its results freely available to our scientific community? Does not what I've just said about scientists apply equally to cultural workers generally? And aren't we all cultural workers in the deepest sense? If we, as a society, want our culture, including science, to be creative, there's no choice but to sustain the broad cultural community. Any attempt to enhance innovation by narrowly focusing resources on an elite cadre of supposedly creative individuals endangers innovation, because we can't know in advance who, in retrospect, will be regarded as outstanding innovators. And because we would impoverish the ideosphere in which their brains would have to work. Teachers are a core component of our cultural community. We willingly pay kindergarten teachers not enough, because they enrich society by infecting our and other children's brains with ideas. It's true that a few of these kindergartners will go on to write heart-rending novels, compose poignant music, midwife world-changing inventions, and so on. But we value teachers' work in its own right, not just because it occasionally contributes at many removes to unanticipated, conspicuous cultural achievements. The Omicron variant is a rare, unpredictable byproduct of worldwide community infection. Likewise, great cultural achievements are rare, unpredictable byproducts of the vibrant, all-encompassing culture of a free people. And when unfree people are liberated, it's a triumph for culture as well as for justice. The Nakba, the catastrophe that Zionism has inflicted on the Palestinian people, has an essential cultural dimension. Great swaths of Palestine's rich culture were pillaged or destroyed in 1948, and the campaign of erasure and dispossession has continued ever since. The erasure hasn't been very successful. Nowhere is Palestine's sumut, the steadfastness of its resistance to dispossession, more evident than in the cultural realm. Subjugation has engendered a defiant efflorescence of Palestinian arts and a driving appetite for scholarly and technical achievement among Palestine's youth. But let us not draw a perverse conclusion. The resilience of Palestine's culture in the face of oppression is not a justification for oppression. It's been the burden of my argument that culture, like a pandemic, thrives only in communities. Zionism's apartheid regime, its forcible segregation of Palestinian communities in order to protect its ethnic supremacy, is intolerable cultural deprivation. It's cultural deprivation for Palestine. It's cultural deprivation for people around the world. It's tragic cultural deprivation for the Jewish people in whose name the oppression is being perpetrated. When unfree people are liberated, it's a triumph for culture, and it's what justice requires. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, George, for this pointed and inspiring and ultimately generous illustration of the unity of intellectual work, both across disciplines and around the world. We know how persistent a virus can be given COVID-19. And this metaphor that you've brought to us actually gives a great cause for optimism. As a mathematician, I think about what I've learned about exponential growth from watching this pandemic arise from something undetectable, the way you were describing Omicron, to something that dominates the world. And your lecture has entitled us to hope that great ideas will arise from who knows where. They're there now, we just can't see them because they're too small still. Well, now is the time for discussion of the issues that you've brought up. The audience has been contributing questions and comments on the chat, and I think we have posted some of them on slides, so we can all see these questions and can discuss them. So I'll read this and it can be translated. Has the advent of social media reduced the selective pressure on ideas in the ideosphere? What do you think, George?
Surely this is true. I think that everyone outside of Palestine who is aware of Palestine's rich culture has experienced being able to do that only with the advent of social media and the internet. So I should say, I don't do Facebook and stuff. I'm not in what's usually called social media, but I have relied absolutely, crucially, on the internet to try to understand what is happening in Palestine, and in particular, its culture, because this is the way we understand the world, I think.
So you're pointing at the fact that the internet and social media has, it's speak, increased our zero, perhaps. It's allowed ideas to spread more quickly, more easily. But could we go back to the previous slide? I think there's another question here. The question is asking whether less fit ideas are allowed to flourish more readily because of social media.
Okay. I didn't understand the thing. Yes, as social media allowed unfit ideas to predominate, whereas in a more strict cultural selection, they might not. Yes, I guess that's probably, I think that probably has to be true. This is really, one way to look at this is that the ideosphere is greatly increased and that gives more room for niches for unfit ideas to arise and to prosper locally. So this is a common theme in ecology, where you have local populations where mutations can be fit. They might be deleterious mutations, but until that population mixes in with a other population where where these kind of deleterious mutations don't predominate, only in those circumstances do the deleterious mutations become extinct. So I think that that we have given more room for many ideas, and some of them are unfit ideas with the internet and social media in general. But I'm not sure that on the whole that this is a bad thing, because after all, from some people's point of view, lots of things that we might find to be very fit ideas are very unfit ideas. So I guess I would look at it another, one way to look at this is that it's an expansion, a huge expansion of the ideosphere. And the ideosphere isn't totally mixed, and nor are any biospheres. So this gives the possibility for ideas to proliferate locally, even if they couldn't survive if the population were totally mixed.
And now local doesn't mean geographically local anymore, but conceptually local, intellectually local.
Right, of course.
So we had another question here. So could we conceive of a mathematical model of the propagation of ideas similar to those of viruses? Could we define a basic reproduction number in R0 of an idea?
That's great. R0, by the way, is, I think some people aren't aware of what that means, but it's the so-called reproduction number. And that means that it's the average number of people under certain circumstances, the average number of people that are infected by one newly infected person. It's really hard to define in a pandemic of viruses, and it depends very much on the environment and so on. And I would not undertake mathematical model of this. So Haynes said that I was really interested in mathematical education, but this was at a very elementary level. So I'm gonna let Haynes take on that job, or maybe someone else from MIT.
It's gotta be a collaboration with other people for sure, George. All right, so that's gonna be left unknown. I think there are studies about this. Okay, another question. Can you talk about the dynamics within scientific research? So how issues of class and race and gender and geography stop possibilities for creative work?
Talk about the last first, geography. This is kind of the whole point of apartheid, of segregating communities, and segregated communities, that cuts off many roots of sharing in the ideosphere. For example, Palestinian universities can't get buy the material resources for research. It's difficult to do that. It's not easy to send samples from the US, for example, to a Palestinian university. So geography, when it's artificially segregated, as in apartheid, is, that's an example of restrictions on scientific research. So class, race, and gender have been remarked on for a long time. And certainly class in many societies, and I would say my own country is an example, your socioeconomic class makes a huge difference in your life prospects in the cultural realm. which is pretty much the entire realm. Your life chances depends critically on class. People, there's very little class mobility from parents to children compared to parents. It's very difficult. So that's a major one. And of course, race plays greatly into class as well. I would put class and race in this context to be very closely related aspects. As for gender, I think that in our country, the United States, gender is increasingly disappearing as a determinant of science culture. And I think it's fair to say that, you know, like in our arts and things like that, it's rapidly disappearing as well. But that's not necessarily the case in other societies as well. And if we take the case of Palestine, for example, not so much gender discrimination, but the different worlds that are available in the occupation to men, young men and young women can make a big difference on, for example, whether young people go to university or directly to a job, that kind of thing. So all of these are constraints on the blossoming of culture, whether it's scientific or not.
So there's some interesting comments that are related to this that just showed up. That one of them talking about in the context of hard sciences, the ideas have to find a path to reality through experiments, and one of the hardest walls that Palestinians find to overcome is the lack of structures and access to materials. I wonder if you have a comment about that problem that Palestinian scientists face.
Yes, it's absolutely shameful how difficult the Zionist occupation has made it for universities and schools in general, but especially universities, to do ordinary university things. I mean, this isn't about material and hard science so much, but, you know, like yesterday there was an article in Haaretz, kind of the Israel's major international newspaper. I subscribe to the English edition, that describing what has already been described, that the occupation has now announced that the Israeli military will determine who gets to be a visiting scholar at a Palestinian university in the West Bank. I mean, this is a police state. this is what a police state does. And I think a police state is a pretty good description of the governance of the West Bank. and part of that is putting huge hurdles for ordinary, completely routine sharing of material resources. You can't buy things easily and you can't share resources easily. And if you don't do experiment, I had a whole lifetime, and I think the most enduring pleasure was the lab as kind of like my basement workshop, doing things with my hands. And if that's impeded, what an impediment to the delight we take in doing science. And I'm sure this applies to many other disciplines as well, besides biological science, which is what I did.
Beautiful. Maybe someone can put a link to the Haaretz article in the chat so we can all have access to it. You can see another question, a slide question. Thank you. What can we do to improve the contagiousness of ideas, especially in the context of occupation?
We could have more Bisan lecture series, I guess. I mean, that's one small thing that we're trying to do to improve the contagiousness of ideas. We have small exchange programs. Now it's going to be hard for us to, for example, for senior people like, you know, professors and so on, to serve in the in Palestinian universities, and almost impossible in Gaza. I mean, Gaza is not, it's worse than a police state. these are things that we have to overcome. And speaking as a US citizen, one of the most important things we can do is to change the mentality and attitude of our own government. Our government greatly facilitates the police state in the occupied Palestinian territories by protecting Israel in international fora, especially in the United Nations Security Council. We vetoed countless resolutions that would, in small ways, take Israel to account for what they are doing in the territories. Maybe our own work might really focus on our own country, if we're one of the countries like the United States that supports this police state ruling. That's what I think might be the most important steps that we can take. But we as scientists can do what we can in order to ourselves integrate more fully with the Palestinian academic community.
And there's a kind of follow-up question in the chat that just appeared. How do we address the ideological vaccinations against contagious ideas?
Well, that is a metaphor that I didn't think of. Vaccination against ideas. Yeah. I don't know. Could we consider? Hegemony. Sorry?
It's called hegemony.
Yeah. Yes. Could we consider the separation wall as vaccination against unwanted ideas, unwanted in the view of the police state? that's a really interesting idea.
I mean, I think that there's an unspoken assumption in many conversations, especially about Israel and Palestine, that constitutes a vaccination against ideas of liberation in Palestine.
Well, yes, I think that I'm not sure that Israel has a very ineffective vaccine against the spread of the idea of liberation. It's not been very effective because that idea has endured and been strengthened over all these decades of occupation.
Maybe we can have another slide question. Yeah, thank you. So in social systems, political, economic, cultural components interacting, where do you see human rights advocates positioned? How can we use science to influence the other components of the international community to affect change in Palestine toward liberation?
The human rights advocates. Well, I think we should all become human rights advocates. I mean, this is a matter, it seems to me, of education of ourselves. We need to learn to take into account human rights in our ordinary professional lives. And I think that that's increasingly coming into being. But human rights, human rights advocates that are professionals focused on human rights are, you know, they're important, but maybe more important than that is to make everyone a human rights advocate, sensitive to human rights. When they make their calculations about what to do, what they'll do in science and any other discipline in the arts, and just to keep in mind to include a commitment to human rights in their everyday calculations about what to do. So we see this, for example, in the many artists who ordinarily wouldn't think twice about coming to perform, for example, in Israel, having second thoughts when they take into consideration that this, in effect, is a support, if it can be seen as a support for the regime that Israel has imposed on Palestine. I mean, they could have second thoughts. So I'm a supporter of the boycott, divestment, and sanctions call, BDS call, including the academic and cultural boycott of Israel. This is not a boycott of individual Israelis, of course. It's a boycott of complicit organizations. And I think this is a good platform to help our fellow academics, our fellow citizens, understand what's at stake in Palestine now.
Thank you for that. Maybe we have another slide question. Can we see another slide?
Yes, I can see this. Okay, so let me read it, okay?
Thank you.
About the hypocrisy pandemics, Western opinion is deeply concerned about the crimes of Russian invasion in Ukraine, and rightly so. Can one take advantage of this situation in order to change the way people think and react about the crimes of Israeli occupation in Palestine? Okay, let's say that some heavily armed country, let's say Russia, invades another country, let's say hypothetically Ukraine, and insisting, claiming that they, the Russians, are the true indigenous people of this other country, Ukraine. They set up a police state in the country they've just invaded. And among the other jobs of the police state is to determine what foreign academics might be allowed to come into Ukrainian universities as guest scholars. That, I think, is a very close parallel of what's happening in the West Bank today. So we might consider that, using that analogy. And I mean, the analogy is it's sort of like almost laughably parallel because of Russia's claim that Ukraine is really a part of Russia.
Judea and
that
Samaria.
Might be a...
mm-hmm. Maybe we have time for one more slide question. What about impact of media, international media in particular, on the ideosphere and beliefs?
So the impact of media. I'm not quite sure what this question is getting at, or and what is meant by media, but I'm going to interpret media here as kind of like the mainstream media, the big newspapers, the big TV channels, the things that are used to be the caretakers, the gatekeepers of what's news and what's not. The impact of media in that sense, including international media, is decreasing because of the available of other channels of understanding, of learning. The internet provides an enormous universe of ways of learning about things. Of course, some of the things you'll learn on the internet aren't true. They're distortions, they're propaganda and so on. Yeah, but I mean, is that not also true of mainstream media? I mean, I do think that there's a lot in mainstream media that is propaganda as well. So I think the impact of media in the sense that I'm interpreting media here is decreasing because there's so many other channels. I mean, a good example, I think, is the resistance in Russia to the war or the invasion that it has perpetrated in Ukraine. Of course, if you say the word "vojne," war, to describe this in Russia, well, now you are liable to jail time as much as 15 years. So no mainstream media that's allowed to operate in Russia now says such things. Yet you will see tens of thousands of people, very brave, mostly young people in Russia, holding up these signs. Нет войне, no war, мир, peace. They defy this, and of course they know these terms, that they know what's happening, because the state-controlled media are not the only way that they can learn about what's going on in the world. And does this not apply widely in many unfree states where media are controlled, main media are controlled by a despotic central government?
Thank you, George. Well, I think it's time to draw to a close today. Thank you so much, George, for this wonderful talk, very fruitful discussion. I think all of our appreciation for the reach of biological ideas has been greatly deepened by this. And a big thanks to our able translator, Numir Kazis. And thank you all for participating in this first lecture. Our next talk will take place on April 13th at the same time. We'll have Dr. Hanada Ghanem of Birzeit University. And her title is Post-Justice, Exceptionalism, and the Normalization of Apartheid. Please go right now to the website shown here on this slide or use the QR code and register for this next seminar. You'll get to the registration page and you can register for it then. We'll see all of you in a month. Thank you for your participation.